Welcome to The Industrialist, the show that we will explore innovation in the manufacturing space. I'm here on the show floor of Microsoft Ignite with Bry Dillon, who's an SVP of Partners and Commercial Strategy at Aveva. Bry, it's an honor and a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you so much for having me.
Bry, I wanted to ask you a question about the changing business that you are seeing right now, the changing business model. The environment that we operate right now is as dynamic as I've ever seen it.
Yeah.
How does it impact your customers? Do they need to rethink of how they operate?
Yeah, I think it's a question that our customers are constantly pondering. And it's been something that's been going on for some time. I think the rise of technology and networks and some of the things that we brought to market, even over the past over a decade, has had them considering different business model changes. But I think right now in particular, even more so than ever, of course, the rise of AI and the Gen AI that they see and the capabilities there, as well as the uncertainty with regards to the whole political situations that are happening, which is impacting our customer base is in the process industries, it's in the in the energy industries, in the hybrid industries, manufacturing, and of course they're impacted by all of these things.
And how do they react to it? What does it mean for them to rethink their business models?
I'll give you an example. So back when I started the company, and this is back in 2011, that year we had a keynote presentation by Nalco, chemical company, that was starting to remotely monitor the performance of their chemicals inside their customer environments. And at the time was a pretty novel idea. They could actually change chemical compounds to drive efficiency for their customers. But some customers actually saw that as a bit of a threat. The minute that they start to let third-party companies into their environment, it starts to challenge basically who they are and what they actually do. Because many of those customers, how they differentiate themselves, particularly for the companies that provide commodity product lines, like they differentiate with their process. The other way we start to see it happen is actually more on the opportunity side. So some of the customer base actually start to look at their customers and say, can I take my expertise and actually help our end customers do their stuff better? So Dominion Power is a good example of this. They started actually providing better visibility to the power they're providing some of their end customers so that those customers could have a better understanding of the fuel mix that was used inside of their environment so that they could meet their sustainability requirements. So it happens on both sides. It changes both the, in terms of what are the threats that are coming as well as the opportunities that they can take advantage of.
How fundamental is this change? Is it a gradual, is there a small change, or is this really a rethinking of what they do and it's gonna change how your customers operate?
Dr. Eric Brynjolfsson, Stanford University professor, came and spoke at one of our conferences, and I really liked some of his examples of the history, like electrification as an example, right? When we first did electrification, and they started to replace steam power systems with electric motors, what they did was they basically put it right in the same place where the steam motor was at. And we didn't get much efficiency. In fact, it was more expensive. And I think that's happening right now, unfortunately, a little bit with some of the AI stuff. But the minute they started to break that down into small motors and change the actual process, that's where the real efficiencies came. It took 30 years back here to get there. I don't think companies have that time to do it now. So I think companies are really recognizing that they have to change faster than they did in the past.
So this is really interesting, because on one hand, you can say we need to change what we do today and do it better. But on the other hand, maybe there are things that we can do that we couldn't do before
100%.
That are now possible. What does the future of the new and impossible before look like?
If you look at a lot of our customer base, the ones who are vertically integrated, like for example, oil and gas company that has the entire value chain all the way from from the molecule to the pump station, they vertically integrate everything. And they're driving efficiencies across the entire line. But then you get into ones that are more fragmented. The only way they're going to be able to compete is they have to find a way to also operate vertically integrated. So I think the future is going to be more connected and more dependent upon each other, particularly if you're just one part of a value chain.
So if you're vertically integrated, you can trust the full value chain, the full supply
chain. That's right.
If you are not, how do you build the trust between the partners, as you were saying, able to get to the same outcome?
That's exactly right. So I think part of this comes with building transparency, building reliability with regards to that. And also there's going to be flexibility. I think this is the other issue that our customers are dealing with as well. You can't just count on the fact that that's a good supplier for you. It's having to figure out how do I build resiliency with all these different dimensions. And the only way we're going to be able to do that, right, is really thinking more broader across the how you actually think about operations.
Are you helping customers envision what the future could look like? What are the opportunities that they maybe haven't yet thought about?
For sure. I mean, we do our best, of course, to try to be able to, you know, share what we think the future is. But the other thing we try to do is try to get the customers to talk to each other and share their insights together. We host executive forums. We host executive roundtables. We try to bring those customers together because at the end of the day, we obviously as an organization, you know, as a society, we have bigger challenges, right? As a society that we have to deal with, right? Like just think about the U.S. as an example. Like it's about 4.4% of all energy consumption comes from the data center market. And that's gonna either double or triple in a very short amount of time. And we have to be able to, how are we gonna be able to supply that? And at the same time, we have to do so in a way that doesn't put us in a more debt than we already are from a sustainability point of view.
How are you dealing with this inside the Aveva as an organization? How are you taking on this challenge?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's a journey. You know, we have kicked off, you know, this an entire program on AI for everyone. We have people that are, you know, and it's like any kind of change. You have your leaders, you have your, you know, you have your followers, and you have to get into the ones that are really willing to take it on. And so we're trying to empower those people, get those people to really be the change agents for the organization, just like we have to do with our customers.
Is there a particular program or methods that you found more impactful or useful? Anything you want to share or guide others through with?
Yeah, look, I think for me, it's always around building belief, right? And belief generally comes, it depends. Some individuals can have belief without evidence, right? They just believe and they can envision and they can go execute, yeah. Right? So identifying those people, but then when they do create the evidence, it's just about sharing and promoting and showing the impact of the evidence that you've actually done. So, I mean, it actually hasn't changed. I mean, it's the same way in which, you know, you get technology adoption you have historically. I just think that the difference here is that the implications of this start to feel a lot more threatening than previous technological revolutions have.
Is it because it's happening faster or is it because it's qualitatively different?
I think it's qualitatively different. I also think that you just have to watch the news. I mean, I was watching 60 Minutes 2 days ago. The Anthropic CEO, as an example, talked about, you know, the potential that half of all entry-level jobs could be gone in the white collar in the next 1 to 5 years. And so I think the threat is something that's much more palatable to people that are in industry.
Than the opportunity that it may be somewhere in front of us that we may not be able to envision or see.
Correct. That's right. And so I think that's the thing that we have to help people with.
So what would be the one thing that we would want to share and guide your customers with? How do you approach this problem? What is the right way to behave?
It's just like any challenge you deal with in life. It's actually no different than any obstacle you face. Right, it's oftentimes in the beginning, the first thing we see is the things that takes away from us. The next question is, what does it actually give us? And I also think we have to disassociate ourselves, our value with our knowledge. But a lot of individuals actually associate, you know, their worth with how much they know, not how well they grow. And I think that understanding, like, if you can turn yourself into focusing on how well you grow, I think that will be the big change to help people really be able to make it through these transitions.
Bry, thank you for the advice. Thank you for the conversation. It was a pleasure to have you on The Industrialist. Thank you.
Thank you so much, man.